Good morning, church. I am Amanda Schoolcraft, and I am super excited to be bringing another entry into the 21 Days of Prayer for this January. I'm always super encouraged by these times of prayer together, and just really looking forward to hearing from all of you and participating in this together as a church. I don't have any profound insight that I've gained since the last time we did this. But I do have just continued, anecdotal evidence that prayer does in fact work and affect our daily lives. Over the course of 2020 and now leading into 2021, I have embarked on some pretty major life changes. Namely, the main one I'm going to talk about today is becoming a foster parent. So I have had, nine foster kids so far since October. I have two here currently right now, and they have all been uniquely challenging with their own specific traumas and just baggage that any kids in the system carry with them. And no two of them have been the same, even in sibling groups. They've all had different needs and no two of them have been the same. And it's been incredible the way God has made it so that I am the right person for each of them. There have been some I've had to say no to, some I've said yes to that didn't end up coming. So I know that He is filtering which children come to me and for how long they are here. And it's just been amazing to be resting in the confidence of praying to Him in those decisions of when to say yes and when to say no. I'm not perfect at it. I'm still worried I'm going to mess that up. But God has just been so faithful so far in sending me exactly kids that are supposed to be here. And I think it is a really cool testament to the way that He was able to knit things together and to take seemingly disparate things and put them together into His overarching plan. I often say that the God that is not the God that is most impressive to me is not the big act God, the parting the Red Sea God or the fire down on the water-soaked altar God, these one-time events. What's most impressive to me is when He's able to work over generations and disparate family lines to bring things together to be a beautiful thing. And one of the easiest examples of that is He wants to grow the nation of Israel, right? But in order to grow the nation of Israel, we have to start way back with, a man getting the wrong wife and then therefore having, a favorite son and then the brothers despising him and then that favorite son, Joseph, being thrown into a pit and then being rescued out of the pit by one compassionate brother that happened to see slave traders going by, and the slave traders wouldn't exist unless the previous generation hadn't messed up because they're Ishmaelites. And then, him getting carted off to Egypt and then him making the right choices in those moments to be able to elevate himself to the point that when there was a famine in the land, he was able to save his family and not only save his family, but get them to move to Egypt and have a safe space to grow and to thrive and to become a great nation in Egypt, but then not get complacent there because they ultimately became enslaved and had to come out. And now here we have this nation of Israel. But that was, multiple countries and multiple generations and multiple people all making what they believed to be, independent decisions, hopefully prayerfully, especially in Joseph's case. But independent decisions that came together for this overarching, beautiful plan of God's. And it's just been, it's so often difficult to see that in our daily lives, difficult to see it in the moment of, what that big picture is. And I still have, no idea what God's, huge picture is for my life, but He has just been so generous with giving me little glimpses of little pieces of good that I am able to do or little ways that I am the right fit. My current kids, for example, can't share much about them publicly, but they are not old enough to really be talking for themselves, so they can't really communicate with me in a meaningful way about what they need, and that's difficult, having a random child thrown at you that can't tell you what they need. And then to add to it, they're primarily spoken to in Spanish at home. When they got dropped off to me, the caseworker that brought them here had forgotten or didn't know that I speak Spanish. And the relief on those little kids' faces when I was able to greet them in the language that they knew was really awesome. And DCS didn't do that on purpose. You know, they didn't bring them here on purpose. And I had almost said no to them because I had some big work deadlines that I was concerned about meeting with them here. But clearly I was supposed to say yes, because if they'd gone somewhere else over the weekend, they likely wouldn't have had a foster parent that spoke their language. And then the way my community has stepped up to support me, I've had people bringing me stuff and offering to help watch them because they're very little. And it's like God made it right. God made it right to say yes to that. He made it right to step into that before I even knew why. And now I know a tiny piece of why. And again, I'm sure there's way more to it than just the language. But yeah, he gave me a really solid yes. Like, that was the right call. Good job. So I guess I would leave that as an encouragement. This is really rambly, and I'm sorry. That if you are trusting him in your decisions, and if you are resting in him daily, even the things that seem like they're just your choices will be a part of what he's doing in this world. And that's just an amazing honor to be able to participate. So I would just encourage you to spend time with him, both in this structured time with the church and in our evening calls, and just all throughout the day with yourself, that everything you do is a part of something that he's working on, no matter how insignificant it may seem. I love you all. God bless you, and I'm looking forward to more of this.